Now, if I can, at this moment, let me try to relate to whatever questions you may have.
Mayor, you spoke earlier about, like, the frustrations that black people have been going through and are going through. I'm frustrated to a point where I'm ready to give up on the system. But, like, I am a black youth. So can you, or what would you tell me to do in terms of, like, whether following the system as it is or going on off and developing, in as much as I can, a new system?
Let me tell you, as a brother, stay in that system. And I'm telling you to stay in the system because to do otherwise is to, in fact, bring down upon you, me, and every other identifiable black person in this country genocide.
But we're already in, like, this genocide state, you know.
I understand what you're saying, but I'm also telling you that there are limitations as long as the system remains in some form of viability. There's some limitations upon how far anything can go in this country that could amount to genocide. If you would point out to me, for instance, you'd say, well, in 1942, they took some 100,000 Japanese Americans and just put them in the concentration camps. Or if you'd say to me also that right now, there seems to be undeniable evidence that there is established within this nation 6 or 7 large detention quarters, that there has been some suggestion that Washington intends to put obstreperous black Americans or others who tend to fight against the system in. I'd have to accept that you're right about it, but I'm also saying to you that there's been some victories won by the use of the courts. Let's take the Chicago incident involving the Black Panthers. Because of the system, the charges against the Black Panthers there had subsequently to be dropped. Now, the system did not move from that point to prosecute those that in the report of the grand jury said had actually done the shooting and the murder, but at least it went a step further than it would have if you didn't have some kind of viable system here. In the absence of it, not only would you have had Fred Hampton dead and the others charged in court, maybe some others dead also, but certainly having to face first-degree murder charges, but also you would have had a general reign of terror of indiscriminate murdering of those who happen to be black or to differ with the system. And this country is, I would have to admit to you, teetering on the brink of whether or not it is going to observe at least the modicums of the protections of a democratic system, as opposed to evidencing some of the signs of going into a totalitarian system. But I can say to you without equivocation and in a sense of preservation of both you and myself that you can't beat the system by violence. And if you just think about it for a minute, you're talking about a country that's got the anti-ballistics missile system, it's got the Polaris submarines, it's got the Army, the Navy, the Coast Guard, the CIA. Well, do you know what would happen if they turn, as they can turn, on an identifiable minority group in this country? Well, they'd wipe you out tomorrow morning, and as horrendous as it would be to me and you, it would not be inconsistent with history. It would not be inconsistent. It was just 25 years ago that the Germans exterminated 6 million Jews. That wasn't back in the times of the Romans, the times of the Greeks. That's just in the last 25, 27 years that they did that.
So what you're telling me then, like, is
I'm saying to you that you can't win going outside of the system and trying to use violence to change it. That your and my only hope is to stay inside the system and make it work, along with some other people in this country that you might find out are just as interested in seeing to it that democracy does survive as you and I are. I don't think that that silent majority that Mr. Agnew appeals to consistently and continuously are actually all of the majority of bigots that he thinks that they are.
Yeah, well, like it's like it gets down to a thing of a slow death instead of like an instant outright one. You know, like I'll continue along in the slow process of getting annihilated as a people, you know, instead of going on out and dealing with a confrontation for whatever ends it may bring.
I can understand you feeling like this. There's an awfully disturbing number of young people, black people, other minority group people who have that same feeling that you have. That's what's dangerous. That's what we keep trying to say to the President of the United States, that because of feelings expressed publicly like yours, just an honest feeling that you really reached a point where if you have to go tomorrow, you're willing to go today. Well, the only thing that I can say to you is that one thing is a sense that if you decide to take that route, that they will bring tomorrow to you today. And they'll bring it to you with relish, with alacrity, and with a finally being able to frontally rid themselves of a very troublesome problem. But as long as the system remains at least in form, then we've got a hope of doing something about it. When they go after you, they go after me too. The fact that you happen to be a mayor or a member of Congress, a member of some state legislature, or that you are a doctor or a lawyer, when that point comes, no one our color is going to escape it just because they happen to occupy a position. Yes, sir.
Well, from the things that you said, I noticed a few things about your speech. It seems that Richard Nixon, since he's been president, is perpetuate genocide to an extent that America has not seen yet. And this genocide extends to the point where 28 Black Panthers in the last, since Nixon has been president, have been killed. And I was wondering how you relate to this government planned genocide and how you relate the genocide to the organization which is suffering the most repression from it and which is trying the hardest to serve the needs of the people, and that is the Black Panther Party.
Well, I think your remarks are just complete with inaccuracies. For you to stand there and to tell me that the Black Panthers contribute more and are doing more to try to alleviate the problems of Black Americans is just absolutely and totally without any kind of foundation at all.
Well, see, that's a very easy statement, I'm sure,
now,
for you
just
to make.
A minute. Now, are we going to be able am I going to be able to answer your questions?
Are you going to say anything as a question?
Well, now, have you finished asking the things and stating the things you want to? I'll just wait until you get through, and then I'll try to respond.
Go ahead.
Are you through?
Well, for the time being.
Genocide in America is not new to Black Americans. This has been a pattern of American life that when you say 28 Black Panthers have been in some manner executed within the last 2 years, I can just say to you that we've had over 5,000 Black Americans lynched in the United States in the last 35 years. Now, Richard Nixon, when I give him credit for some things that some Democrat presidents didn't do, it's just a fact. Not one Democratic president introduced what is contained in Nixon's family assistance plan. What it does, as inadequate as it is, it recognizes for the first time that people are entitled to some kind of decent minimum level of living without the maze and the contradictions and the bureaucracy of the present welfare system that happens to operate against those who need it most, receiving the least benefit, and those that essentially and probably need it least, receiving the greatest benefit. And although Nixon's family assistance plan floor level is too low, at least what he's done is to offer to this country something that those of us in the Democratic Party have fought for years. And in addition to that, he took another long-held Democratic proposal, namely that of revenue sharing, and has introduced that. And he's introduced those two Democratic engendered proposals in a Congress that's composed of Democrats who are the very ones who today won't pass it. Now, with all of the things that Nixon does wrong, and I could give a whole lecture on what Nixon has done wrong, but if he's done some things right, all right, I'm going to give him credit for those. Those are two things he did right. And they're more right to me because they happen to have been things that Democrats have always said they want, but when the time came to really get them, refused to move to do so. Yes, sir.
Mr. Mayor, are you running for vice president of the country? Are you going to run for vice president with John B. Lindsay? Are you going to run for president? Or are you going to run as a running mate of Ed Kennedy in 1972? Now, I've heard your speeches. It sounds like me, you're going to be a candidate for president, and I'd be proud of this. But as a black American, I think that we need more of you. We need more of you, your type of American, to speak out now, because we have throughout the country people who get into the black revolution and claim that they are black when they're white and they come from a rich home and they don't understand our problem. And they talk about, as you says, about 28 Black Panthers who don't represent the mainstream of the black community, when 25 to 35,000 black Americans throughout this country, throughout history of this country, have been lynched, have been murdered, have been maimed, have been denied the rights of the Constitution rights. Millions, I mean, have been denied their rights. Mr. Mayor, I'm so happy that you spoke out against this type of thing that happened here today.
Well, let me try to answer your questions.
Okay.
It's very flattering to have had some of the reports about whether or not I could be a candidate for vice president. In fact, it says something about the country, one of the good things you can say about the country, that people can speculate as to whether a black Carl Stokes is going to be a candidate for vice president. But I have no ambitions for office higher than mayor, and the reason very simply being that I wanted to be mayor because I felt I understood some of the problems that afflict us in the central cities, that I had personally had the guts and the willingness to make the political sacrifices necessary to come to grips with the problems, whatever they may be. And if you read our Cleveland newspapers, you'll find out that every week I'm in some kind of trouble with somebody in our town, but always on the right side. The only thing they can ever say is that when Stokes raises hell, he's raising it about what's right, that the city isn't moving on housing, on racial discrimination, it's not moving on the problems of the poor, it's not moving on the environmental problems that rest so heavily on those least able to escape them or to do something about it. And it's meant that I've had to come into conflict with the business establishment. It has meant that I have had to battle a continuous running battle with a predominantly white city council that I have there. And it's meant that I've had to battle the two newspapers in our city. But the reason that I was able to battle them is because I never had to think about being politically careful, because if I get these people alienated, They'll stop me from going on to the next office. I don't have any next office I want to go to. I want to stay in Cleveland. I want to try to be a mayor. I want to try to come to grips and to make some substantive impact on those pervasive, grievous problems that we have. I know that's going to take a long time, a lot of resources, and a willingness on the part of whomever is at the head of the city to not pander to political expediency. I'm willing to do that, and I'm going to stay there as long as they let me stay. Yes, sir.
I want to go back to the first questions you were asked in this session and just ask you why, if every time you're confronted with questions that deal with other black organizations like the Panthers and questions that maybe you don't want to answer for fear of putting yourself on the record, do you always use your black skin as a defense against answering questions from white radicals, or would you like to talk about the issues and the problems and the theories instead of just, you know, putting down someone because you don't think he's sincere? I think you ought to take for granted that many white so-called radicals aren't really dedicated, but you should also look into the fact that there are a lot of white radicals who are struggling with their own racism and that of other white people. And to the man who's talking about white people trying to join the Negro Revolution, I think that we're not trying to join a Negro or a black revolution. We're trying to build a revolution in our own community that can work with a black revolution against the same oppressive forces. And I want to know, do you always answer questions like that with a snide put down instead of talking about the issues? And if you don't, would you try and talk about the issues a little bit?
Well, my answer to you would be that I usually answer a question in the same sense and manner in which the question or the statement is posed to me. It's like, for instance, I caution my brothers and I caution you against using violence, but that does not mean I'm nonviolent. For instance, if I walked off this platform and you punched me in the nose, you'd get one of the damnedest fights you ever had in your life. I don't put down people except those who use some of the very tired, exhausted rhetoric that has no meaning and that has just come to be that which is used, just like, for instance, a certain manner of dress. Now, I don't care how a person dresses. I don't care how they talk. I believe in freedom. It's just like I believe in your freedom to swing your hand in any direction you want to, as long as it does not come into contact with me. And so when you pose to me some didactic statements that just leave no possibility for there being anything other than your own exclusive possession of the facts and the truth, I just answer you in the same way. First, that you don't have any exclusive on the truth. You certainly don't have any exclusive on the facts. And I've got as much of a right to answer you in the manner in which you talk to me as you have to originally speak to me in that manner. Now, anybody, I think I've tried to answer the things that the young man, your friend, asked me in the first instance. I've never. If you knew anything at all about Carl Stokes, and if you'd ever been to Cleveland, you'd know that I never duck. I don't duck whether it's with you or with a policeman or anybody else. I wouldn't have all the trouble I have had if I ducked things. So I say to you, you can ask me anything you want to about the Black Panthers, about the White Panthers, about the Ku Klux Klan, or anything else, and I'll answer your specific question. But I'm going to say to you clearly that you don't intimidate me and don't nobody else intimidate me. Now, let me finish one other thing for you because I think you need some help on this. If you're going to be a revolutionary, then you don't have to come over into the black community where the Black Panthers are. You do your revolt right where you live. I haven't heard of any of you carrying on a revolution out here in this Westchester County. I haven't out there in the suburb of Shaker Heights. I haven't heard them carrying on any revolution out there. But I find that every time that the black brother is somewhere, here come a bunch of punks to try to raise hell and take advantage of it. Now, Now, I got in the office because of assistance and the work and the support of white persons. I'm in office now. I have white people working for me. And I can say genuinely, some of my best friends happen to be white. And I pay them well. So, but there's no question in my mind or in theirs, if they're going to be honest, that they, when you grow up in the American society and you're white, you're going to have some racism in you. Now, what it is a matter of degree. And I don't want somebody getting up telling me about other white races when, hell, he's a racist himself. The question is, what degree is he a racist? So if you say you're struggling with your own racism, I applaud you. I'm glad to hear it, because to struggle with it means to acknowledge it. And I say to you, however, that this whole problem of trying to bring about corrections in this nation that has so many problems has often seen people try to use other people. And I wouldn't accuse you of doing that, because I think you may be one of those genuinely motivated to the extent that you understand what you're doing. But I also say to you that this is your country. If somebody can really reform it, you ought to be the one that can do it, because you happen to have been privileged to have been born white. And meanwhile, you let the black people get over there and do their own thing if they happen to be of some kind of revolutionary mind. Yes, ma'am.
You've been thrown many black bouquets tonight, Mayor Stokes. I'd like to throw a white one. You seem to have a great deal of compassion. Does this stem from your childhood? And if so, would you tell us a little more about your childhood and what motivated you?
Oh, I got a lot of help along the way. I started out with a mother who had only a fourth grade education, but my mom always kept telling us, if you get an education, you can make it in this country. You can be somebody. And why she had such a fundamental belief in a country, having come from the South where the blatant discrimination of Negroes was just so dramatic, I don't know. But she did infuse me both with that belief that the country can work, as well as with that motivation to get an education. So both my brother and myself, both of us did well in school, but when I got to be 17, by then I'd sort of hit the streets. I got a little accomplished in shooting pool and learned a few other things out there on the street. When I was 17, for no reason in the world, because I had good school teachers, I had a motivating mother, but I dropped out of school when I was 17. And I was out of school a full year, and fortunately, the Army came along and drafted me. And I went to the Army. And while I was in the Army, I used to box. I used to do some amateur boxing at that time. And when I got into the Army, one of the fellows who was on the boxing team with me was my same age, but he'd already graduated from high school and had had 1 year of college at Wilberforce. And then there was another fellow that we played basketball with, and he also had already finished school and had a year down at Tennessee State University. So, you know, here I am with those guys. They're my buddies, and we went through almost 2 years in the Army together, as they would talk about going back to school, and I'd always realize that I hadn't even finished high school. And then, so the old motivations of mom and the school teachers I had were reinforced by my two friends, because I felt inferior around these fellows. There was no reason why they should have gone on and been able to go to college and I couldn't, but so I decided if I ever got out of the Army and got back okay, that I'd go back to school. Well, I did get out of the Army, and I went back to high school in 1947, graduated from high school, and I want you to say that wasn't easy when you've been in the Army, you're a man, you've been to Europe and knocked around a little bit, and you're going to school with much younger fellas.
But I got my high school degree, and then in 1947, I went down to West Virginia State College. I was able to continue on then because of the GI Bill of Rights. Otherwise, I wouldn't financially have been able to do it. But when I got back to Cleveland after leaving West Virginia State, then I went to work as a liquor enforcement agent and saved my money, and then I went to law school up at University of Minnesota. And ever since then, I've been in school, got back on the track. Well, listen, let me thank you for having come this evening and talked with me and discussed with me some of the things of our common concern. It helps me to talk with you, and I hope I've been able to give you some of the notions of what I think we in this country need to do and some of the things that we can do to try to make the country a little bit better. It was a good evening, and I appreciate it. Thank you.